In this screencast, we will look at how a first-order transfer function responds to a step change in the input. We will do this in two parts. The first part, we will look at a generic transfer function, which has a gain k, time constant tau. So we want to see how a transfer function with this generic gain and time constant reacts to a change in magnitude m as a step function of our input variable x. The reason why we're keeping things in generic terms, k, tau, and m, instead of numbers, is because if we develop a generic relationship, this relationship will hold for all first-order transfer functions, not mattering both the magnitude of the values or what type of process it is. Once we have done that, we'll use the answer for part A to allow us to assess the transfer function part B relating the height of fluid in a tank to the inlet flow rate. Part A is asking us to look at how a step function of magnitude m for our input variable here x influences our output variable here y. So what we first have to do is, since our transfer function is in the Laplace domain, we have to turn our variable, our step function magnitude m, into the Laplace domain. So you can use a Laplace transform sheet and know the fact that the Laplace transform of a step is just m over s. So what we can now do is substitute in m over s for x, and we end up with y over m over s equals the generic first order transfer function in standard form. If we move the m over s over, we end up with y equals km over s times tau s plus 1. We cannot take a Laplace transform of this function quite easily, so we have to use either partial fractions or the Heaviside method. Here we'll use partial fractions, and this will just become a over s plus b over tau s plus 1. We then find a least common denominator for our process, which will be s times tau s plus 1. And we know the fact that the numerator has to equal km. If we look at our terms on the left-hand side of this equation, we see the fact that the highest power of s here we have is s to the first. If we factor a out, we end up with tau times a in the s to the first power, and then we also have a for s to the zeroth power. For b, we just have bs, there is no s to the zeroth term, just an s to the first term. So now we have to match this to what our right-hand side is. So there is no s term, so therefore the s to the first term will just be 0, and our s to the zeroth term will have to equal km. Well, this makes our mathematical lives not terribly difficult, because we've already shown what a equals km. And what we then have is tau times km plus b equals 0, and that allows us to solve for b, which is equal to negative km times tau. Substituting these values in leaves, now that we have separated out the two terms, we can easily take the inverse Laplace transform of both of these. The inverse Laplace transform of km over s is just going to be km. And the inverse Laplace transform of km tau over tau s plus 1 is going to be km tau. The constant multiplied by the inverse Laplace transform of 1 over tau s plus 1, which is 1 over tau times e to the negative t over tau. The taus will cancel, and we'll have a minus sign coming back down. The inverse Laplace transform on the left-hand side will just simply be the y of t. If we factor out the km, we end up with an answer of km times 1 minus e to the negative t over tau. So if we want to see what this means graphically, we can see this is an exponential of some sort. So if we sketch this out, where our x-axis will be time and our y-axis will be x of t and y of t, x of t will just be a step function of magnitude m. And if we were to sketch this km times 1 minus e to the negative t over tau, it would look something like what is drawn here. And there are a couple important values here. The first is the fact that this function will converge to km. Why it will converge to km is the fact that
at long times, the e to the negative t over tau term will approach zero because t will get high, so it would be e to the negative infinity, which was zero. So therefore, at long times, this function will converge to km, so in other words, the steady state of the system. Another point to note here is the fact the curve here was drawn such that the steady state value is larger than the step function. That would indicate the fact that the gain here is greater than 1. But note the fact that it could be drawn such that the steady state ends at the same place of x of t, which is where the gain would be 1. A value less than x of t, which could mean one of two things. The fact that the gain is less than positive 1. And it also could mean the fact that the value could go negative, meaning the fact that the steady state gain is negative. One more important landmark is when y of t equals 63.2% or 0.632 of km. What that corresponds to is a time that is equal to tau. So with this information that we have obtained, we can now begin to solve part B,
which gives us information about a first-order transfer function relating the height of fluid in the tank to the inlet flow rate. So therefore, our input variable here would be the inlet flow rate, which we'll call here QI, and the output variable will be the height of fluid inside the tank of H. It says that is a first-order transfer function with a gain of 10 in units of height per volumetric flow rate. Our time constant is given as 50 seconds. That gives us that our transfer function is 10 over 50s plus 1. It gives us information about the steady state system where the inlet flow rate is 0.4 and the fluid height in the tank is 3 meters. And the inlet flow rate is increased instantaneously to 0.41 cubic meters per second. So the first question is, what is the height of the fluid in the tank 100 seconds after the increase has occurred? So in order to analyze this, we're going to substitute in our variables here, which are K, which is the steady state gain of the process, that is 10. M, which is the magnitude of the step change. So here, the problem statement states that it has increased instantaneously from 0.4 to 0.41. Therefore, our change in magnitude is 0.01. And that our tau in this problem is given as 50 seconds. We're interested in what's going to happen at a time of 100 seconds. So if we substitute everything in, we can find some information about y of t, where in this case, y is the output variable, which is h. When we substitute all of these numbers in, we get an answer of h equals 0.086 meters. But at first glance, this may look strange because our initial steady state height inside the tank is given in the problem statement was 3 meters, yet all of a sudden our answer is 0.086 meters. So this doesn't make any sense. But it makes sense when we understand how we developed that y of t function. So to gain some better insight on this, let's quickly resketch our process here. For a first order transfer function, we notice the fact that at the end it converges to km. At time equals zero, the system equals zero, not the initial height. Even though it is often not explicitly shown, the y of t relationship represents a deviation from the steady state. So what that means is that the final height is really h bar plus the h we found, which is going to equal 3.086 meters. So again, important point to note here is the relationship that is provided here is basically in deviation variables. The second part asks, what will the steady state value be for the height? And if you recall from our analysis before, is that as t goes to infinity, the exponential term goes to zero. In other words, y of t is going to equal km as t approaches infinity. So what that means is that our steady state height is going to equal our original starting height, h bar, plus km. So here, that will be 3.1 meters.